Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Edinburgh Nights, recorded here at the Gilded Balloon. My name's Arthur Smith, unless there's anybody here from Streatham Tax Office, in which case I'm Daphne Fairfax. I'm the compère here this evening. Compère's kind of French for Leslie Crowther. And I'll be introducing the acts as the evening wears off. Well, I thought since we are at the Edinburgh Festival, I ought to do something kind of topical and relevant to kick off the evening. So I don't know if anyone saw the Olympics last year. What I really enjoyed in the Olympics last year was where that bloke bashed his head on the diving board. Do you remember that? That was good, wasn't it? Well, boom, there he goes. I wanted to see it again. And they showed it again, didn't they? Boom, there he goes again. Boom, there he goes again. Review of the year. Boom, there he goes again. What I would really like to have seen would have been one of the synchronised swimmers drowning. And then the other one would have to have drowned in exactly the same way. I've been trying to keep fit myself since I've been in Edinburgh. I've got these parallel bars at home. So what I do is I run at them and try and buy a drink from both of them. Now, since you ask, the most embarrassing thing that ever happened to me, and I don't know if this has ever happened to anyone here, but when I was at school one day, I accidentally called the headmistress Mummy. And it was particularly embarrassing because I was teaching at the school at the time. Okay, she's a member of the Royal Shakespeare Company, mailing list, and here she is, Jo Brand.
I'll just start by moving the microphone stand because you won't be able to see me otherwise, will you? Here I am. And look, I've gone again. But it's all right because I'm back now. Well, you're obviously thinking she's not exactly what you'd call anorexic. Well, I'm sorry, I've decided that I probably am, actually, because... Well, anorexic people look in the mirror and think they look fat. And so do I. So I must be. And my weight problem actually got a lot worse when I went on the pill, so that proved to be a very effective contraceptive. Thanks. And if you do weigh more than an ant, fashion can be a bit of a problem for you, really, can't it? You look through all these fashion magazines and you get the subliminal message that unless you're a size 8 or below, you might just as well slip into your favourite lime green crimpleen trouser suit and set fire to yourself outside Chelsea Girl. And, I mean, yeah, I do think that women go out and buy a lot of very strange things in the name of fashion and personal hygiene, like panty liners, for example. Well, why do they bother? I'd like to know what was wrong with those navy blue baggy knickers we used to wear at school. They had a double gusset which would protect you from the blast of an all-out nuclear attack. And you could get your mum shopping in them on the way home. And I think we women are going to have to suffer the terrible indignity of going into Boots and saying, "Can I have a packet of panty liners, please?" Why can't they call them something nice? Like fairy hammocks, for example. Like everybody's got two different types of knickers, the type you don't mind showing to people, and the type you wish you'd buried 6 feet underground with a wooden stake through them. Women have got two types of knickers, the first type are black, made of lace and the size of an atom. The second type of grey, the size of Buckinghamshire. And you have to spray a hell of a lot of Charlie on them before you can wear them anywhere. You might be a little bit surprised to find out I'm not married, and to be honest, I'm getting a bit desperate now. But if I was going to get married, there are two groups of men I certainly wouldn't consider. First of all, graphic designers, because they're so boring, and... I know this because we've got three living next door to us at the moment. They're all called Gavin. They all drive Renault 5s. And their Renault 5s are all called Gavin as well. But I think potentially the worst man as a husband has to be what you would call a Cosmo man. He's the man of the 80s. He's intelligent, sensitive, caring. What a boring old bastard he must be, eh? But I shouldn't be rude about him because, of course, he is incredibly right on. His car isn't penis-shaped. Unfortunately, neither is his penis. You probably noticed, haven't you, that I've done about, I don't know, 6 minutes and I haven't said anything about periods yet, have I? And I'm sorry, but being a female comic, it's in my contract. I have to talk about them. But I'm going to keep it fairly brief and I'm not going to moan about them because I think they're great. I mean, especially, for example, if you know somebody you can't stand with a white sofa. I only do that to make a few men run out and vomit. I like that bit. But actually what I like most about periods are the very strange euphemisms that people use for them. There's some odd ones around, aren't there? Among my favourites are, I've got the painters and decorators in. Arsenal are playing at home. But my own particular favourite is, there's a vast amount of blood squirting out of my gusset, Vicar. I think I have to go to church now. Thank you for listening. Good night.
I'll tell you what I hate. You! I hate you! No, I hate those watches. I do hate you, actually, but that's by the by. No, I hate those watches that bleep on the hour and kill blind people at traffic lights. Let's... Diaries are very good. Now, let's bring on the next act of the evening, because I'd like to introduce... I'd like to introduce Lenny Bruce, but he's dead, unfortunately. So instead, a worthy substitute, another fellow Scot, like myself, more or less. Well, at least he lives in Edinburgh anyway. And here he is, Norman Lovett.
Thanks. Ready to drink, it says on here. Of course it is. Saves me bending down. Getting on now. Getting older now. Yeah, it's true, I live here now in Edinburgh. I've lived here for a year now. And mainly, one of the main reasons I moved up here was to get away from all the comedians in London. Now they're all up here, still they all go back tomorrow, so... Get shot of them for another year. It's very different in Edinburgh to London, and more polite, nice to you up here. I remember I was here down here about a month, and one morning I had to go and get a couple of 60-watt bulbs from the shop. A particularly busy day I had. Always been a bit musical. Popped along to Morningside, just had a stroll down. Then saw the electrical shop, I went inside, nice little ding on the bell when I went in. There it is. No, I enjoyed that. And I went up to the counter, there's a man there in brown coat and collar and tie, and well groomed, very well groomed man, about 55, 56. 57 could have been a push shot, all right, buddy. I said, 260-watt, two of your best 60-watt bulbs. And he said, I'll just try these for you. So, and he screwed them in the socket to say, and he didn't do it quickly to say, oh, that works, that works. He put it in and stood back with me and we watched it glow. We stood back and admired it. And he said, yeah, that's a good one you got there. Put them in a bag, he wrapped them up and he put the sellotape on. Sometimes I say elastoplast, I get them muddled up at home sometimes. I cut myself and put some sellotape on. But you can watch it healing, you know. I bought some milk the other day. I mean, I do it a lot. And it says, open other side. Not please, you know. No, bloody. Just so bloody rude. So rude. Just. I mean, I don't expect them to say, oh, hello, Norm, how are you today? But could you open the milk on the other side? Thanks very much indeed. Just rude. I was thinking today, I was having a little think, and you know when you toast brown bread, how do you know when it's done? Joke brother. Right, I'm going home now. Thanks very much.
Norman Lovett there. Norman Lovett, and it's a good job he was speeding tonight, actually. Yeah. He was talking about how horrible it is. London, it does get you down. London, London, it's dirty, nothing works, there's dog turds everywhere, you know, and that's just my flat. No, in London, you know, I've decided to do my flat up in London. I called a builder and asked him to give me a quote. He said, do not forsake me, oh my darling. I said, you're a bloody cowboy, mate, you know. Well, now, most of the acts on the bill tonight are sort of old hands who've all done a bit of telly before and know what the score is. The next act on tonight has not done any telly, I'm sure, because he won the Gilded Balloon, So You Think You're Funny, last week, and he won it because he's extremely funny. Please welcome onto the stage, Phil Kay.
I was actually born in Edinburgh. And I spent most of my childhood growing up. I lived in a wee house over on Princess Street. Do you know the quickest way to walk from here to Princess Street? It's like this. My mother, she was very mean to me. She hated me from the minute I was born. I think it was maybe because I was an early baby. I think it was born about 6 o'clock. I think I woke her up. She said, you disturbed my beauty sleep. And looking at her today, I think she never recovered, you know. When the doctor came in, he held me up to smack my bottom, you know, to get me breathing. My mother said, that's all right, I'll do that. She grabbed me and she was slapping around and hitting me, and she dropped me and I smashed my wee head on the table. And she feels quite guilty because to this day you can still see a wee dent just on the table by the top of the leg. Mind you, it's not easy being a mother. It must be fairly hard, especially if you're an alcoholic and you hate kids, you know. She used to drink a lot. She used to drink a lot, in fact, she still does. Her idea of a slow gin is one that takes more than one gulp, you know. Mind you, she had a tough marriage. She was married to my father. He was trained in languages and he worked as a Russian interrupter. He's seen him standing at the back there, you know, Russian dignitaries talking, and he'd be muttering over their shoulder, you know. He said he enjoyed his work. I think he enjoyed it. He used to come home every night and celebrate it by drinking a hell of a lot, you know. He told me he enjoyed it, not so much as a job, but just as something he really enjoyed doing, you know. And he told me this when I was on the phone to my friend, you know. He was descended from his father. And he was also very lazy. He used to use a wheelchair and a Zimmer. When he was 15. He was full of wonderful, useful advice. He once said to me, Phil, two's company, 35,000's a crowd. He's a fan of football. I went to Spain, I was very nervous because, you know, I get seasick. It's lucky I was flying then, wasn't it? I was walking down the beach and I saw this lovely couple, Raymond and Alison from Scotland. I don't know if you know them. Oh, you do, right? And he had this wee baby with him, and he was 4 months old, and already he was bald. She said he took after his father, which obviously, yeah. But I thought, you know, I'm not very good with money. It just slips through my fingers. There's no joke there, sorry. So I'd spent all my money, and I thought, I think I'll hitchhike up to Paris. So I was hitchhiking for 3 hours in Spain, and I only got 10 yards, and that was when someone hit me with a car, you know. Apparently, you know, different things mean different things in different countries, like words, for instance. Apparently, you know, in Italy, that means, you know, go away or something. And in Scotland, it might mean, you know, come here, there's a phone call or something. But, no, no. Well, in Spain, apparently, this means drive past me. Hi, just drive. Whoa. Drive past me. 3 hours I was there. Apparently, I don't know what they think you're doing. Maybe they think you're just, you know, admiring their car, going, that's lovely. Oh, what lovely kids, great time. I made my way up to Edinburgh. And I'd been away 6 months. I was walking down the street. Edinburgh's so yuppified now, isn't it? This tramp came up to me and said, oh, you got 60p for a quassel? I was walking down the street and I saw this church, and I'd been away, I was melancholy, I was sad. Sad to have left my holiday, but glad to be back, and I saw this church at the end of the street. Its doors were opening. It was beckoning me inside to pray or something. Now, I'm not usually the religious type, so I just went home and watched TV. You know? To end tonight, I just like to finish, right?
Actually, Edinburgh is just obviously packed with performers and whatnot. Now, I went to have a bath yesterday in my flat in Edinburgh, and I got in the bath, and a Belgian mime artist plopped out the tap. And it transpires that my bathroom is venue number 42. He was bloody good, actually, this mime artist. It's a bit cramped, what with the Scotsman reviewer in there as well, but... And of course, you have to have your publicity while you're up here. Of course, some groups haven't been up for long, and they've only been up 1 year and had a crap show in the first place. So you see it sometimes. I saw one group up here this year, and their publicity said, quite good, Radio 4th. All right, great. Leave me to it. Ring me a cab now. Whoa. The next bloke doesn't need that, because he's brilliant. He's the sort of bloke who, when he's not on stage, the sounds of his one-liners are still reverberating round your head. Here he is, Michael Redmond.
You all right? Good. Because I'm not. Thank you for asking. The reason I'm not feeling very well is I got very drunk last night. I ate a tin of dog food for a bet. I actually lost the bet. I'd bet that I wouldn't eat it. Wish I had more material. I'd like to break some new ground now and talk about something which, as far as I know, no other comedian has ever talked about. Me. I was born in a place called Blarna Gosha. I don't know whether you know it or not, it's a small village just outside Ireland. They're fairly simple times. I remember family evenings around the fire, my father fretting about the coming harvest, my mother consoling him because he was a chartered accountant, didn't worry about that sort of thing. Like most people from Ireland, I was born a Catholic, which actually came as a bit of a shock to my parents, who are both Jewish. I was speaking about religion because, although I'm not religious, I am quite superstitious. For example, if I pass one nun walking along the street on her own, I know it's for luck. If I pass two nuns walking together, I know the chance of getting off of both of them is very slim. Any nuns in the audience, by the way? Just my luck. I was never really very religious. I don't come much for the idea of eternal life. I mean, I can put up with most things in a lifetime, but I can't really see myself going through eternity without attacking Chris de Burgh with a kitchen knife while he's on stage singing Lady in Red. Now, it's not just Chris de Burgh. I mean, music has become so bland, hasn't it? I mean, it's people like Rick Astley and Jason Donovan and all this crap. And I mentioned Jason Donovan there, and I'm actually having a serious argument with my girlfriend at the moment about watching Neighbours twice every bloody day. What a load of mindless dribble aimed at people whose lives are so bloody empty they have to fill it with this crap. I said, calm down, Margaret, it's not that bad. And I've had a rather unusual week this week, which isn't really that unusual for me, I suppose. I was on an escalator in a large department store yesterday. I was the only one on it going down. The one coming up was completely crowded. I thought, what do the bastards know that I don't? When I got to the end, I decided to come back up. As I was on my way up, all the others was going back down again on the other escalator. I bloody hate when a crowd of complete strangers play a practical joke on me. That's all from me. Thank you very much. Good night.
Okay, please welcome the funniest American woman in Edinburgh at the moment. Here she is, Kit Hollerbach.
I'm so nervous. Gosh, you know, this is like television. It always makes me nervous. I mean, God, I remember my first gig. You know, I walked on stage. The spotlight hit me. A drunk had thrown it from across the room. But honestly, you know, an old comic friend of mine, he once told me this. He took me aside. He said, you know, Kit, the audience can smell fear. Of course, he used to shit himself as he walked on stage. You know, oh, dear. But I live here. I'm married to an Englishman. By that, I mean he eats pizza with a knife and fork. Sunburns under a 50-watt bulb. And he wears pajamas. You know, with the top button done up. And a tie. And he's useless. Like, I'll send him to the store, you know, to get some Tampax. Not because I need them, but just to humiliate him. And I have to say, living here, you know, that I've made some observations about the British people. I think they're very tolerant. I mean, how else would you explain hundreds of years of an inequitable class system and appliances that are sold without plugs? How could this be an optional extra? What, are you going to save up for the plug? What? I spend time at home, you know, watching television because, and I'll watch everything, anything. I'm not discriminating, I don't discriminate at all. Anything, I just turn it on. And I like commercials, even those, like, soap powder commercials, because I care. I'm particularly fond of the one where the woman complains. She goes, gosh, I just don't know what to do about those nasty bloodstains on my husband's shirts. If I were her, I'd ask a few questions. What about the guy who's got blood, egg, and sweat? What did he do? Beat up a chicken? But my favorite show in Britain, I just love it, is Open University because I think it's so intelligent. And I can't imagine like how people really tune in, you know, to the program. It's sort of like click.
The unification of quantum electrodynamics with weak nuclear interaction yields a quartet of intermediate vector gauge bosons that coexist with a sextet of quarks.
Honey, come on in here. You're missing the good part. And get me a beer, will ya? But I'll tell you the real reason I watch it. I watch it because nowhere ever before in my entire life have I seen a more scintillating selection of flared trousers. Thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of the program.
Kit Hollerbach there. Well, little point, if anyone's interested, doing a sponsorship, I'm eating quiche for unborn foxes. And I will be answering questions about animals, questions like, you know, coots, bald as a coot, deaf as a coot, queer as a coot. Why do coots get such a bad deal? And how is it they have risen to being bankers to the royal family? Here is the ineffable, the second Irishman on the bill, Mr. Sean Hughes.
Great to be in Edinburgh, I must say. And now, first off, one thing I have to say is there any football supporters in tonight? Exactly right, because people think that football supporters are yobs and hooligans and violent. And no, and it's not true, because I was talking to you earlier on, wasn't I? And we were having a completely reasonable conversation. He was there saying, how is your wife and family? That was you, wasn't it? So don't give him stick, right? It's a hard life. Because I used to play football when I was a kid, like, well, nothing professionally. Played for Leeds. But no, because I used to play like in the park, like with the two captains of the two bullies in the class, and all us wimps are all lined up waiting to be picked for the team. Like, so they're kind of going, I'll have Gizzo, you're with me, mate. Crinky, I'll have you, mate. Dimbo, you're with me. And I'm going, I'll play in goal if you want, guys. I'm really good in goal. And they go, Sharon, Debbie, you're with me. I say, sorry, Sean, there's an odd number today. Why don't you piss off? fair enough. I'll go home, sir. I'll bring the dog for a walk. Come on, Patch, let's go. So anyway, I'm walking back with Patch, with my little dog Patch, and the school captain calls back and says, Sean, what? Patch is picked. Oh, have a good game, Patch. By the way, has everyone been picking up on the political connotations behind the act so far? Good, because I'm being a little subtle tonight, but tonight I'll be making a lot of political statements with my hair, so watch out for that. South Africa. So, I was in a shop, and this guy came running in with a balaclava on his head with some aerosols and said, give us all your money, the ozone gets it. Green vote for me. Chili. But what else has been happening? No, the worst thing I've seen since I was up here, I saw this old lady being mugged by three guys. Now, I don't know about you, but I cannot tolerate violence of all women. So I went over and said, hey, because I had a microphone. I was in the Scouts, and you know our motto. Fair enough. So I said, hey, I too come from a socially deprived background, but I have found other outlets to vent my frustration with. I don't remember much after that, really. But some good did come out of the experience. I found out at that moment that we all have a guardian angel, because just as this guy was about to hit me over the head with a machete, I heard a little voice inside my head saying, you're on your own, mate. But the thing was, like, you know, they were hitting me, they were punching me about, and I said, I don't blame you. Go on, hit me if you want. I blame your parents. And that really annoyed them. Like, I said, go on, hit me if you want. I blame your parents. And I do, because they were there behind them saying, go on, get the hairy, get one for me. Birmingham. No, see, but I think I'm going to finish off now by telling you the most embarrassing thing that ever happened to me was... Now, the most embarrassing thing was I was having sex once, and another really embarrassing thing was... I was having sex once, and I was thinking of somebody else while I was doing it, and the name just slipped out. And it's really awkward, because you have to answer all those embarrassing questions, like, who's Patch? Just a dog I play football with, nothing serious. Thank you very much, enjoy the rest of the show, and good night.
Not unusual to be loved by anyone. That was Sean Hughes. I put this on. It's largely amusing because you can see the outline of my testicles. They're curiously arranged in the shape of a map of Italy. I don't know why, but there's Girona. Ooh, thank you very much. It's made entirely from nylon, this outfit. I don't know if you remember the days of nylon. You used to have nylon sheets, nylon pyjamas. You get into bed at night, you'd be whooped straight out the other side. I used to be a walking hydroelectrical storm in those days. Here he is, the inevitable, the legendary, the marvellous, the lots of long words, the Arnold Brown.
Don't like too much applause. That's how fascism started. This is Scotland. This is Edinburgh. I was walking in the streets of Glasgow, as I usually do, in my routines. When a man came up to me, and he had seen better days, it was a young conservative. And he said, hey, Sonny, I like that. He said, Sonny, do you think you can see a way to give me some money for a surveyor's report? That's Thatcher's fault, giving people big ideas. And then the poll tax. We got the poll tax first. And the Conservatives are saying they didn't represent their policies in the right way. We didn't understand what they're doing. I think I understand what they're doing at last. The Duke of Hamilton will be paying the same poll tax as a single-parent family. That's egalitarian. All paying the same poll tax together, rich and poor. The classless society, don't you understand? Oh, I pay the same poll tax as the Duke of Hamilton. Now, if there's any people in the audience tonight who haven't filled in their poll tax form, like dissidents, I want to give you a hint. You've got to define your relationship to other persons in the household. So I put, going through a bad patch. I said, I didn't realise that her career was as demanding as mine. And in retrospect, I was taking her for granted. But I put a very optimistic note at the end. P.S. Do not worry. You've got to give the government hope, haven't you? We hope to resolve the situation by the time the assessment is due. Why do the Conservatives never march? Why do you never see them demonstrating? Eh? Have they got everything they want? Or are they just ashamed to shout out what they really want? More tax cuts for the rich? Stuff the disabled? It's a very difficult phrase to shout out in unison, I can tell you. I mean, Thatcher, that's easy, isn't it? Altogether. I must admit, alternative comedy is booming, and I'm cashing in. We're all cashing in, as socialists, we're all cashing in. I'm actually Arnold Brown, PLC Holdings. And the definition of an alternative comedian is someone who pays more income tax than Ken Dodd. Sorry, Ken, I love you. That's your business, isn't it? Thank you very much.
Arnold Brown! The last act of the evening. Here he is. He's been storming it, and that's because he's very funny. He is everyone's favourite, John Hegley.
OK, this song is called Eddie Don't Like Furniture, and it's about a bloke called Eddie who don't like furniture. Yeah, and it's an attempt to comprehend this guy's world. It's an unusual thing not to like furniture, but I think if a few more of us try to understand people's unusualness, it might not be such a horrible world. Yes?
Don't clap that name.
Don't you patronise me, boy. OK. How we doing for level, boys? Eddie don't go for sofas or settees or those little tables that you have to buy in threes. The closest thing that Eddie's got an article of furniture's the cheese board. Eddie doesn't bolster the upholstery biz. There's a lot of furniture in the world, but none of it's Eddie's. Eddie don't like furniture. Furniture makes Eddie really miserable. Eddie don't like furniture. Na 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 na. Eddie don't like furniture. Na 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 na. Eddie offers visitors a corner of the room. You get used to the distances between you pretty soon. With everyone in corners, though, it isn't very easy when you're trying to play pontoon. Oh, happy families. He once got in a rowing boat. They offered him a seat. It was just a strip of timber, but it wasn't up his street. He stood himself up in the boat and made himself feel steady. Then he threw the plank onto the bank and said, "Furniture, no thank you." When it's on a bonfire, furniture's fine. Anytime that Eddie gets the number 29 bus, even if the seats on top and plenty down below, Eddie always goes where the pushchairs go. Does Eddie like furniture? I don't think so. Eddie don't like furniture. Na-na, na-na. Eddie don't like furniture. Na-na-na-na-na-na. Right, we'll have a bit of audience participation on this chorus, I think. We'll divide you into three sections. Section A. Section B. And you, sir. Section C. Okay, section A. You have the first ner section. I say, Eddie don't like furniture, and you go, ner, 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 ner. Okay, let's try that. Eddie don't like furniture.
Ner, ner, ner,
ner. Okay, section B, let's see if we can be a little bit better. Section B, after the second Eddie don't like furniture, I'd like you to go, ner, 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 ner. And let's try this at home as well, okay?
Okay, section B. Ready with your nerves? Yours is no, 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 no. Okay. Eddie, you don't want to like furniture.
No, 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 no.
Well done. And section C. Section C, after the third, Eddie, don't like furniture. I'd like you to go. Okay, I'd just like you to go. Only a joke, section C. Only a joke, only a joke, only a joke. I would like you to say, na, 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 no, no, okay, so it's a... No, you can't have it again, mate. Quite funny, but don't be funny, mate. That's my choice. Okay, everybody, here we go then. Section A, your starters. Eddie, don't like furniture. You don't like furniture. Not yet, not yet, not yet, not, not yet. You wanted to come in a bit soon there, didn't you? Probably the story of your life. Only a joke session. Here we go. Eddie don't like furniture.
Na na, 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 na. Na 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 na.
Section C, yeah. That's it's really nice, man, when somebody isn't in the spirit of it like that. Well done. Specky. If you go round Eddie's place and have a game of hide and seek, it isn't very long before you're found. And in a fit of craziness, Eddie took the legs off his dash hound. That stopped him dashing around. Eddie quite likes cutlery. But it don't like furniture. If you give him some for Christmas, he'll return it, yeah. Thank you very much, bye.